video file of that seminar. Just send me email and I'll send you link to the that file. In particular, say Stuova and some other people I was invited were invited. They could not come, so they asked already for that video link. And for sure, I'll send it to Alexei, and he can distribute as he wants and or use for his other lectures. So the our speaker today is Alexei Marchenko. He professionally works on ice. He is professor on ice mechanics at the university in Svalbard. Actually, it's not university, it's a university unit, or how would say it?
Center,
university center, okay. And we had already seminars on ice, but they were more about modeling ice and mathematics of ice. So now in this presentation today, Alexei will combine both mathematics, experiments, and his experience. Wow, Peter Vadam join us. Okay. Hi, Peter.
Oh, hi, Alex.
Very good. So we are recording that. Okay. Yes. Okay. Yes, good. So then, Alexei, could you start your presentation, sharing your screen? And please, all others, switch off your camera and mute your microphones, please. Yeah. And me too, I will do the same. So that is a little bit increase the, improve the connection, if any. Yeah, okay. So. Alexei, please, your presentation, and I switch off your my camera and mute my microphone.
Everything is your presentation on screen.
Yes, I can see your presentation. Everything is fine. Would you change slide, please?
Yeah. So then.
Yeah, it works. Yeah, sure. Please start.
Yeah, I started. So then here you see the content. So I will tell, I have all together, and the first will be structure of columnar ice, introduction for those who is not familiar with this. Then I will tell about elastic and viscous elastic properties of transversally isotropic materials in relation to sea ice. Then I will touch theory of wave attenuation below viscous elastic ice cover, and then return back to experiments to determine rheological constant of sea ice. And then I use this constant to estimate wave attenuation below viscous elastic ice cover. So I will tell only about wave attenuation below solid ice, continuous ice, it is not broken ice. And finally, we have some conclusion and discussions. So then a few words about columnar sea ice. So then here you see on picture A photograph of brine channel in the ice, and on two photos of thin sections from the left, you can see structure of horizontal thin sections in the top right corner and the vertical thin section. So that is typical columnar sea ice, which is isotropic in horizontal plane. And it is called S2 type ice. So then all thin sections are made with when room temperature is around -10, -10, -12. That is temperature when we can prepare these thin sections. So, and at this temperature, we cannot see brine inside ice. We can see only some rest of channels. But of course, there is some brine, but these pockets, they are very small, and we may see them only in microscope. So then there is porous space. So first I mentioned about columnar structure, and second I mentioned about liquid brine content and gas content in the ice. So liquid brine fill pockets and channels, and this continuum could be permeable or not permeable. And these studies were performed in by Vicks, Eckley, and later by Golden et al. And Hayo Aiken. So, and some general property was derived based on the experiment with laboratory made ice, that if ice salinity is around 5 ppt and ice temperature is above minus 5, so then this ice is permeable. So it means that some brine pockets are connected by channels. And when we apply pressure gradient, so then brine can move by channels. But if ice is colder, so then brine channels are locked and ice is not anymore permeable. But still, it includes some inclusions of brines. So therefore, it is always porous material. So then each column in ice represent not necessary monocrystal. And inside columns, we also may have small brine pockets with liquid brine. But of course, but nevertheless, each column is more solid material. And we have something between columns. It could be precipitated salts, so, or it could be some ice with high concentration of dislocations. So then altogether, I can summarize in this scheme, so that columnar sea ice, that is most typical sea ice, is transversally isotropic porous material. So it is not isotropic, it is evident, but it is isotropic in a horizontal plane. So therefore, I'm telling about transverse tropic. And porous space is filled with liquid brine and gas. Some brine pockets are connected by channels, and porosity and permeability depend on temperature, salinity, and also deformation and stresses. So this experiment we made on compression of sea ice demonstrated that when ice is compressed, it can lose property of permeability even if it is warm. So then, if I will look on Hook law in transversely isotropic material, so then properties, elastic properties of such material are characterized by five constant. So elastic modulus and Poisson ratio in horizontal plane, and elastic modulus in vertical direction, Poisson ratio, which show how material expand horizontally when we compress it in vertical direction, and the shear G prime, shear modulus when we apply shear forces and look for the reaction of strain and stresses in the X zeta and Y zeta planes. So amount of constant is bigger than in isotropic material, but when we look for one-dimensional deformations in plane, so it is enough for us to use only two constant, elastic modulus and Poisson ratio in horizontal plane. And the same property is valid when we look for bending deformations, because bending deformations, they are realized through compression and tension in a horizontal plane, but the sign of tension, the sign of deformation is different in different parts of the plate. So when, for example, when plate is bended with negative curvature, we have in top half of the plate, we have tension, and near the plate bottom, we have compression. And in some place, we have neutral plane with zero compression. So, so therefore, it is enough for us to use rheology in plane, ice rheology in plane to model bending deformations. And it is important that we distinguish that property is in horizontal plane and in vertical directions are different. We need to choose a proper coefficient, rheological constant to model ice bending deformations of ice. So the theory of thin plate is constructed traditional theory based on Kirghhoff-Love hypothesis that displacements of vertical cross sections, vertical lines, they are realized just due to their rotation relative to the middle surface. And then we can, using this hypothesis, we can express displacement ux through the angle of rotation, which is proportional to the slope angle. So it is derivative from eta by x. And zeta here is a vertical coordinate, which coincides with normal coordinate to the middle surface of the plane. And then we can calculate the strain components xx. It will be proportional to the curvature of ice surface or middle surface of the ice. So then we also can calculate strain rates, and the strain rate in the middle of the plate equal to zero, but at the plate top and near the plate bottom, strain rates are not zero and depend on the derivative on the vertical speed of surface elevation. And so then when we go to more realistic properties of we need to mention that ice has elastic properties, of course, and elasticity is very strong in the ice, especially when we apply load over a short time and over a small distance. But in addition to elasticity, we may observe creep deformation in ice when we apply load and keep load some time, and ice begin to deform with constant strain rate, and strain rate is proportional to the stresses, and the stresses in some power. So then this property is called creep. And when we release the load from the samples, we observe that some part of deformation return back immediately due to the elasticity, but some part of deformation return back after some time, and it is called elastic lag. At the same time, we observe relaxation of stresses. When we compress ice sample and then keep deformation constant, so the stresses will drop with the time. And this property is called stress relaxation. So, and all these effects are described by this linear combination of Maxwell and Kelvin of void units. They, of course, this combination doesn't describe all details observed in a real ice sample. For this, to describe all details, we may consider more complicated combination of this unit and then choose some coefficients. But this configuration is just simplest, which describes these four properties, which are most known for the ice. And the goal of my studies was to identify coefficients in this rheological constant in these models when for horizontal samples of ice, when we consider horizontal deformations of ice or bending, in contrast to vertical. So this combination of units is described by equation one, where sigma is the stress and epsilon is the strain. And dot means time derivative with respect to the time, and two dots is the second derivative with respect to the time. So this is equation one is second order differential equation with respect to the time, and it includes several constants, five constants, the properties of this rheological model. One constant is elastic constant from the spring in Maxwell unit. Then a dashpot in the Maxwell unit include two constants. One constant is the linear coefficient of viscosity, or coefficient of linear viscosity, and another coefficient K is creep constant. So, and eta one is coefficient of linear viscosity. So, and we have also two constants in the void unit, one elastic constant and one coefficient of linear viscosity, all together five constants. And we assume, we don't consider creep, I don't consider creep in this presentation, but in general, I included here the creep because equation one should describe ice behavior in a wide range of time scales, for very fast loads and for very slow loads. So then if we stay in the range of small strains, so then we can ignore this nonlinear creep, where strain rate is proportional to the stresses in power three. So in range of small stresses, we never reach this secondary creep, and we always will have some viscous motion, but it will be described by linear viscosity because of a small production of dislocations. So, and then in that case, equation one is reduced to equation five. Then we have also second order differential equations, but only with four constants. What is important to mention here, that we have here EF, so that is effective elastic modulus, which depend on elastic modulus of Maxwell unit E1, and also on the combination of E2 and the other viscosities. And it is very useful to understand that, and it is written in ISO standard, that the coefficient of effective elastic modulus depend on ice viscosity. And in this interpretation, you see that it is just a function, nonlinear function of viscous coefficient and the elastic coefficients of this model. But I will tell later why this combination is called effective elastic modulus. So if you stay in the range of small times, in the range of processes with small times, representative times, so then we may ignore in equation five term sigma divided eta one, because of typical values, of known typical values for the constant. If a representative time of process is less than 100 second, we may ignore this viscous term in equation five and limit amount of constant in our consideration. So I am telling about this because later I will show experimental results and interpretation of results will be based on these equations. So then how we proceed if we want to include this model into the model of wave propagation below the elastic plate? So we proceed by standard way. So first we need to calculate bending moment. Bending moment is the product of stresses xx on this normal coordinate zeta. So that is moment, and then we integrate this moment over the cross-section of the plate. And then we express stresses through the strains, substitute in this equation, and then we have an expression for the bending moment through the elevation of ice surface. So then when we substitute it into momentum balance equation, we may solve this equation, and we have one equation which is used for the calculation of water surface elevation. And we use the same method just when we consider viscous elastic plate. So instead of Hooke law, we use this rheological equation. You see this equation for viscous elastic plate. And then we multiply it on zeta and integrate over the plate thickness. And we have a relationship between bending moments and the derivative from ice surface elevation. So then we use this expression in the equation of water motion in the boundary conditions. So then if you go, we consider potential motion of water below the elastic plate. So we use Laplace equation for velocity potential, boundary condition at the bottom, two boundary conditions at the surface, and in dynamic boundary condition at the surface three, surface below the ice, water surface below the ice, we have pressure. And this pressure is proportional to the second derivative from bending moment. And bending moment is a function of water surface elevation. So then when we include it into the system, so then we have a closed system of equation with modified boundary conditions. So it's a standard approach. And then when we consider wave propagating below the ice, we need to substitute in this equation solution which describe wave, surface wave in the water. So then dependence from vertical coordinate is given by this hyperbolic cosinus, and dependence from time and horizontal coordinate is given by this exponential term, which is related to wave type of the motion. So where theta is wave phase, and phi zero is the amplitude of velocity potential, and a small is the wave amplitude. They are related by this formula one, and the h, capital H, is the water depth. So that is standard solution of Laplace equations describing surface wave. And we use boundary, so this solution one satisfy boundary condition at the bottom, because when we take derivative from phi by zeta and then substitute that zeta equal minus h, we have that velocity at the bottom equals to zero. So then boundary condition at the bottom is satisfied. And another two boundary conditions are used to calculate dispersion equations. So in case of when ice is elastic plate, we have equation two. So that is dispersion equation for flexural gravity waves. So this equation is well known. Ice inertia is not included in this equation, but usually ice inertia is small compared to water inertia. So therefore this equation is well known. So, but in case of viscous elastic plate, we will have equation three. It is more complicated. it include imaginary unit. So because of course we have viscous elastic plate which introduce damping in the system, and we will derive this damping from this equation. And what I want to tell here is that in equation two we have combination elastic modulus divided one minus Poisson ratio in second power. And in equation three we don't have Poisson ratio. Poisson ratio is coming when we consider Hooke law in 3D form, because in y direction, which is transversal to the direction of wave propagation, we assume that strains are equal to zero. And therefore we have this effect of Poisson ratio. But when we consider it one dimensional rheological model of viscous elastic material, we didn't discuss about the effect of Poisson ratio. But probably we need to take it into account and to write in equation three not just E1, but E1 divided 1 minus square root Poisson ratio. But since Poisson ratio is small, 0.3, so then the difference is not big. Or we may consider that Poisson ratio effect is included in E1. So then it is not very simple to work with equation three, because it is it has many complex numbers inside. But if we know, because of some reasons, if we know that wave damping is small over one wavelength, so then we can simplify this equation. It means that in the first order of accuracy, this equation should coincide with equation two. But in the next order, we will have damping. And this equation is formulated below. So, and near the arrow, you may see these assumptions, which are usually valid when we consider swell wave and wind waves. So omega tau 2 much greater than 1, E1 is about effective elastic modulus, and the loss inequality. So usually they are satisfied. So it means that in the term in equation three, in the term after this E1 H in third power K4, there is some expression. And in this expression, these terms, which are proportional to imaginary unit, and also term proportional E1 divided omega squared eta1 tau2, they are small compared to one. So therefore, we may use Taylor series and move everything up. And equation three will be reduced to approximated form. Omega equal omega fg, where omega fg is frequency of flexural gravity wave determined by formula two. And then in brackets, we have one plus I beta, where beta is some coefficient characterizing wave damping. And below you can see, below this dispersion equation, you may see formula for the coefficient beta. So, and if we are interested in wave attenuation in the space, so then instead of coefficient beta, we should consider coefficient A, alpha, which is product beta on frequency and divided on group velocity. So that is well-known results from old papers of Kaster. So then I will not explain that, but that is just some simple algebra, how to get special damping from temporal damping in wave solutions. So then I now moving to experiments. So because I derived formulas for wave attenuation, and I want to calculate wave damping coefficient for realistic rheological constant of ice. So, and this constant will be calculated using experimental results. And I will consider two types of experiments. One experiments, I call it processes with constant stress rate and strain rate. And another experiment is periodic processes. So when we consider experiment with constant stress rate and strain rate, from the rheological equation, we will find that change of strains will be proportional to the change of stresses with coefficient equal to effective elastic modulus. And the expression for effective elastic modulus is given here. It was formulated on previous slide. And in periodic processes, we see that stress amplitude will be proportional to the strain amplitude with coefficient E1. So that is elastic modulus from Maxwell unit. And it is multiplied on some complex expression. And this expression in if frequency is big, so then it is just one. And from this type of test, we will have we will find the elastic modulus E1 from Maxwell unit. So then first type of test. So that is a floating cantilever beam. So we made beam in the ice, we apply force at the end of beam and measure displacement and force. And we measure displacement not only at the end of beam, but also along the beam. Then we can calculate curvature of beam. And when we calculate curvature of beam, after that, we may calculate elastic modulus, or we just can solve all this problem using finite element method and adjust our measured numbers. So from the test, we have force versus the time and displacement versus the time. And after calculation, we will find elastic modulus. But in the model, we need to, for the calculation, we need to substitute some. And in this situation, we use elastic rheology with effective elastic modulus. So then this graph show typical dependencies of forces from displacement. And they also linear by time. So this test is very good example of test with constant strain rate and constant stress rate, constant stress rate. So then as a result, we will find that effective elastic modulus mean value around 2 gigapascal. We did different tests in different places. So then for sea ice, it is about 2 gigapascal. For fresh ice, it is great. But I'm telling about sea ice. So then this test show typical value for effective elastic modulus, 2 gigapascal. So then we may also perform test on uniaxial compression with constant strain rate and choose a part of stresses and strain part of graph where they depend linearly from time. And usually it is significant part of these dependencies which we may use. And we also from this test, which was made from the same ice with horizontal and vertical samples, which we brought from Svea, we also will find that for horizontal samples, effective elastic modulus will be, here it is a little bit below 2 gigapascal, but for vertical it is 3 gigapascal. So then we will find very similar numbers. So then we go to another type of test. We have a beam. Usually length of beam 70 centimeters, but in some tests it could be 30 centimeters. So then we place this beam on we fix this beam in 2 points, so beam with 3 ends, and we place accelerometer on the surface of beam and initiate oscillations of beam by finger shock. Very simple. The sampling frequency of accelerometer is 10,000 Hertz. Then we have record. So it's clear that we have some oscillations, and these oscillations attenuate with time. But we may investigate spectrum and then use peak frequency as a frequency of first natural mode of the beam. So, and then we may calculate elastic modulus if we know the geometrical sizes of beam and we know the frequency of natural oscillations. So here you see the frequency is 170 Hertz, so that is high frequency test. And another method about which I would like to tell, it is acoustic method. So in acoustic method, we also have a beam of ice, and then we fix acoustic transducers at the side of beam and initiate a wave, acoustic, elastic wave inside. So I use two methods to initiate wave. The first method is just I use shock by screwdriver, shock by screwdriver by one of transducers. And then I have record in line display. I have record when signal started from one side and when signal was received on another side of the sample. Then I know time over which the signal crossed this length. So then in this figure, I have 28 centimeters, but I told that usually we use 60, 70 centimeters length of beam. But then I can, of course, calculate the speed of this signal. And then I need to decide how to calculate elastic modulus when I know this speed. So then if I consider natural modes in the rod, in circular rod, so then these phase velocities of these natural modes are shown on this figure. So A here is the radius of the rod or size of the beam, K is wave number, and on the vertical axis we have phase velocities. So and blue line show the phase velocity of natural modes. So CP is the velocity of pressure wave, and CS is velocity of shear wave. And CR is the rod mode. It is velocity equal to square root from elastic modulus divided on density. So then here you see some typical values, but the question is, if I measure it velocity, so I need to tell which mode I should use to calculate elastic modulus. And of course, I need to set up some value for the Poisson ratio. In other words, I need to very well understand what I measure it in this test. So then it is not simple. So then when I discover it, then when the rod or beam was shorter, I measured speed which are more close to shear wave. And for longer beams, I measured speed which are more close to CR. So then if I use these results from the beam, from long beam, so then you see that I calculated and got more or less similar values from acoustic method and from method with vibrating beams. So then 7 tests seven tests, seven measurements were performed with different beams. Horizontal ice beam at room temperature minus 10. So salinity were measured. Density, I also calculated some densities were measured. For some beams, density were not measured, but they are around 920 kilogram per cubic meters. So then mean value for the test with vibrating beams was 4.94 gigapascal. And from acoustic test was 5.27 gigapascal. So based on this experiment, I may conclude that the representative value for effective elastic modulus is 2 gigapascal. And for elastic modulus E1 in Maxwell unit is 5 gigapascal. And I further will use these values for other estimates. So then, so here you see this value for vertical beams. And then depending on temperature, and I use also test with fixed end beams to calculate their vibrations, and then to calculate natural frequency and elastic modulus. So then results more or less similar. But of course, accuracy is not high. So it is also important to mention here that all tests were performed here with the same beam. The first, I had fixed end beam with lengths about 50 centimeters. And this, I place accelerometer on the top of fixed end beam, initiated vibrations, and then calculated elastic modulus. And perform experiment with different temperature. Several experiments with each value of temperature. Then I cut this beam and made from fixed end beam free end beam. And then I initiated again vibrations of free end beam with support in two points. And again calculated this green line, show this dependencies from the temperature of elastic modulus. And then finally I made from this beam more narrow beam and use acoustic method and calculated elastic modulus by acoustic method. So that was the same beam, but of course measurements were performed maybe over couple of weeks and the room in temperature was changed. So therefore structure of beam also probably adjusted to the situation in the room. And since it was saline ice, so when temperature is warm, salt can leak out from the beam. So then it is frozen again. So it was the same beam, but structure of beam, of course, changed during the experiments. Here I use elastic, I calculated elastic modulus for vertical and horizontal beam from acoustic test. Two the same beams, vertical and horizontal, but not long, 28 centimeters. And here I got that horizontal speed is less than vertical speed. What has happened?
Peter, it seems you are doing something on your computer. Peter Vadim.
Maybe I need to play share content.
Yeah. Start again. Yeah. Uh-huh. Stop sharing and then
good.
Let me check. No, everything okay. Seems okay. Yeah. Now it's fine. Yeah. Now please continue. Okay. And so, you have 10 minutes.
Yeah, 10 minutes. Okay.
Yeah.
So then I consider test on delayed elasticity. for the calculation of time tau 2. So that is time for the relaxation of strain. In this test, we load I score, and then we remove load. And we see that a part of deformation after removing the load return back. So then it is visible on the right figures. So showing the strain. So initially the strain is rising when we keep the stresses and we observe some sort of creep. But when we remove the load, some strains are returned back because of this effect of delayed elasticity. And this effect is used to calculate rheological constant tau 2. So then here you see from this part when stresses, when strains are returned back from the left side, you see delay elastic lag for horizontal sample. And from the right side, elastic lag for vertical core. So then the representative time for horizontal is 75 seconds, and for vertical is 2 times greater, 150 seconds. So that is difference between vertical and horizontal elastic lag. So then when we consider relaxation test, so we set up that strains are zero. So therefore, from rheological equation, we have equation one. So that is equation for the stress. And this equation has solution two with initial conditions that stress equal to constant and stress rate equal to zero in initial time. And then solution two describes relaxation of stresses. And it depends on constant tau 1. And equation 2 is used for the, to calculate this time constant tau 1 if constant tau 2 and gamma are given. Gamma is a ratio of two elastic moduli. And this elastic moduli were measured in previous test. And tau 2 was measured in the test on elastic lag. So then I can calculate tau 1. But in addition to this equation, I need here to mention that below, at the bottom of the slide, you see expression for effective elastic modulus. That is the definition, which was obtained initially when we derived the rheological equation. So, and this equation is used to calculate viscous coefficient in a Kelvin void unit, eta 2. And this coefficient should be greater than zero. And this condition influences this inequality that we cannot use any values for eta 1 and tau 2. But they should satisfy to this inequality in order to get physical values for the constant. So, and here you see experiment on relaxation of stresses. And this experiment is used for the finding of constant tau 1. So then we keep stresses. Initially, we apply some strain. The strain is going up, and then we fix strain. And stresses begin to relax. And you see in the top panel that stresses in horizontal sample relax over 300 seconds. From 200 to 500, no stresses, almost no stresses. But in vertical sample, it is evident that the relaxation time is much higher. So then over 600 seconds, stresses were reduced from 2 megapascal to 1.5 megapascal only, but how much time is needed for full relaxation of stresses, I don't know, but at least the difference between vertical and horizontal samples here is very big. So then I will tell now about only horizontal sample, top graph. And then this is a part of curve, which was used for the calculation of constant tau 1. And green line was chosen as a more or less good approximation. We cannot get detailed approximation here. I told that we need to use more complicated model to reproduce in details strain and stress dependence from the time and real experiments. But here we have this tau 1, 63 second. And after that, we may calculate all other coefficients in the model. I mean, eta 1, eta 2, coefficient mu, and they are in the range of values given in the literature. But there are not so many values in the literature. There are some, especially for CIs and for columnar CIs, I don't know any values for columnar CIs about coefficient of viscosity in horizontal directions. So, and finally, after substitution, these values into the wave expression for wave damping coefficient, we have the following result. So coefficient alpha describe special attenuation of wave. So then it has local maxima. It shows three type of dependencies constructed for different CI thicknesses, 20 centimeters, half of meter, meter, and 1.5 meter. So then each of this line has local maxima. But this local maxima is located in the range of relatively short wavelengths. For example, if ice is of 50 centimeters thickness, so then we have local maxima at 50 meter wavelengths. It is relatively short wavelengths. But nevertheless, we have this non-monotonic behavior, and we have local maxima, which are related to effect of group velocity of the flexural gravity wave. So then on the left graph, you see this coefficient beta, which show temporal wave damping, but coefficient, and it is monotonic. A coefficient alpha is accounted from beta by multiplying on frequency and dividing on the group velocity. And group velocity for flexural gravity wave is not monotonic, and as a result, we have this non-monotonic behavior, which could potentially, which could explain this law of effect. So then some wave have strong damping, but the wave, but shorter wave have smaller damping. And longer wave also have smaller damping. But here I want to tell that this local maxima is in the range of relatively short wavelengths. So therefore, I'm not sure in this conclusion. And I finished my presentation, and in discussion conclusion, I want just to repeat. So columnar CIs should be considered as transversal isotropic material with viscous elastic properties. So, and bending deformation of CIs could be described by linear combination of Maxwell and Kelvin void units. It includes five rheological constant, and this constant determine ice behavior in horizontal plane and during bending deformation. If we consider small bending deformation, then we can use standard approximation of Kirchhoff-Love for describing structure of bending deformation, and then we can derive equation of viscous elastic plate And in case of small damping, this equation will include only two rheological constants from five. And one will be elastic modulus for Maxwell unit, and the viscous constant will be a combination of other coefficients from rheological model. So this viscous elastic plate will influence wave dissipation and wave attenuation. And these coefficients were calculated from the laboratory experiments. Right. Rheological coefficients were calculated, so numerical values are given, and then wave attenuation coefficient was constructed, and the representative distance of swell damping, wavelengths 120 meter long, below the ice is estimated around 10 kilometers. So then it is more or less realistic value. So, and I finished. Yeah.
Oh, thank you very much, Alexey. Very interesting and exciting presentation with everything, experiments and analysis and predictions. So we have time. Actually, we can take longer time for discussions. So please, any questions to Alexey? Any discussions? Yeah. You can just raise your hand or just unmute your microphone and start asking your question. Erlan, are you going to ask question?
Before I leave, I notice I'm late. I'm going to stay. I thought it was a fascinating lecture.
Yeah.
Very much. That was a very clear exposition of a very complicated scenario. Alexey, on the effects of temperature, I noticed that one set of results showed that the modulus, whether it was vertical or horizontal, was decreasing as temperature decreased, whereas another set showed that the modulus, as I expected, was increasing as temperature decreased. Yeah. Why the difference?
I don't know. It is something happening in the ice in the lab. You know, it is not the experiment takes some several days to change temperature, and I was surprised, but you know I checked and checked again and got the opposite trend. But in spring I have another trend, decrease of elastic modulus with temperature increase.
Okay. My other question, if we look at the result which showed that the modulus effective was increasing as temperature decreased, then at minus 20 degrees centigrade, you had a value of the order of about 6.8 GPa, as I remember.
Yeah.
Well, at minus 22, we course all the salinity has solidified, well, most of the brine has solidified. Now, if this were brine-free ice, at about minus 22, the modulus would be close to about 10 GPa. And yeah, extrapolating your number down, it might be about 7 GPa. Is that difference significant?
Yeah, it is significant because you mentioned 10 GPa. It is for freshwater ice, and I expect for granular ice. But in sea ice, we have this many internal boundaries, and when acoustic wave is running through these internal boundaries and interact with different grain sizes, it loses energy. So then finally, and I have two transducers, and in each transducer I have some threshold. So that is the question, actually, what we are measuring. Because if I have initially I have a P wave, and it is transformed during the interaction with interfaces, internal interfaces, and due to the interaction with the surface of sample, what we have at another transducer? Maybe, you know, I have 150 gertz, kilohertz piezocrystal. So now I bought another at 60 kilohertz. Maybe repeat this experiment with bigger wavelengths. So then everything would be in one wavelength. Maybe it will be something different. But the question is that I don't understand clearly what I measure in acoustic test.
Thank you very much. And I'm sorry I have to run off, but it was an excellent presentation.
Thank you, Ilan. Thank you. Any other questions, please? Any other discussions? I noticed that tau 2, actually it's very big. So it's from 50 to more than 100 seconds. So this means, for me, it means that the ice is more viscous than elastic. Is it right?
No. Elastic, you have small elastic part. Small elastic part. So when you apply a lot to the ice, when you compress that,
yes,
and then you release the lot. You yes. have that elastic part of deformation return back during 1 millisecond, very fast.
Mm.
But then when you wait 100 seconds, you see that some part of deformation return back.
Mm.
And it is called elastic lock.
Mm-hmm.
And when you have this wave, for example, with 10 second period, so these processes influence stresses and the work of internal stresses. They eat energy.
Mm.
So this is
for long time process. Long time process. Yes.
Yeah, but when we consider wave, we may tell about a long time observation in one point, or we may tell what happened with wave after it propagates over a distance of 10 kilometers. It is the same, but in other way.
Mm-hmm.
So, and over 10 kilometer distance, this type of processes will influence damping.
Okay.
And but in the lab, you can determine this constant using another type of experiment.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I have another question. So it's about alpha, alpha per kilometer. So I believe it's also big if to compare with the values by, say, Malan or Squire. I believe it's much smaller. So here, yeah, you see alpha is of order one, but I'm not sure it's. Can you compare with the results by others?
But which result? If I consider
alpha.
If I consider 50 meter length, 50 centimeters ice thickness, and wave length 100 meters or 120 meters, so then I have typical scale for wave damping is about between 5 and 10 kilometers.
Mm-hmm. So that is in line with the results by others.
But others, they didn't consider this damping.
Okay. No, they measured attenuation coefficient. Okay, so they measured that coefficient, but this could be because of different reasons, right? Because they broken ice, because of something.
Yeah, the Squire mainly was working with the wave scattering.
That
is different process. And but it is for solid ice. But if we have some flaws, which size is, which diameter is about the wavelength, so it also may contribute.
Mm.
But actually, what I tried to deliver in this work is that this this is big. This damping is big because of ice viscosity.
Yeah.
And if we would use viscosity, measure it with vertical ice cores, so then damping would be very small. You may imagine that somebody took some cores, vertical, which is most typical, then performed some test in the lab and concluded that viscosity is very small.
Yeah.
But if you take a sample horizontal, so then you discover that viscosity is
bigger.
Much more important.
Yeah. And as you explained, this is the horizontal modulus should be taken into account, but not vertical one.
Yes.
All constants
should be horizontal, not vertical.
And any other questions, please? Any, or somebody could comment? Yeah, because I noticed the beta in this slide. Beta you calculated, or beta x you calculated. It's
beta times omega.
Yeah. But then beta, it was calculated or defined under the assumption that omega by tau 2 is much greater than 1. So this means that is for relatively short waves?
Yes.
So the is that condition satisfied for this wavelengths and thickness of ice in this slide?
Yeah, but I think that it is easy to calculate.
Yeah. I'm just asking. Did you check?
Of course, because omega is if a 10-second period, so then we in the range point something. So then and it should be less than 100.
Yeah. So if tau is 75, tau 275, and frequency omega 1 over 10, so then it will be about 7-8. So then it's greater than 1, right?
No, let me go back.
Yeah, to the definition of beta. No, next, I believe next slide before. One slide before. Yeah, over here. Yeah, no, next one. Next slide. Yeah, no.
No, is that what here? Omega tau 2.
Yeah, that one, this slide.
Yeah.
So there is that in between equation 3 and equation 4, that omega by tau 2 is much greater than 1. And
if
then
tau 2 is 75 and omega is near the 1.
Yeah, 1 second. So it's much bigger than 1. Yeah, sure.
Yes.
But the omega equal to 1, then we need from omega equal to 1 to calculate wavelengths, corresponding wavelengths, and to go then to your last slide to find what the meaning of that.
Yeah, but swell is usually 10 second.
10 second
period representative. So then it means that frequency is 2 pi divided on 10.
2 pi by 10. Okay, so
six
about 1.
Point, okay.
Point 6. Yeah, so then it's satisfied. Yeah,
it's satisfied.
Yeah, it's long waves. But okay, anything else? No. Then First of all, thank you, Alexey, for a very nice lecture and explanation and your new results, exciting results with the about everything. Peter, would you like to say something? No, your microphone is muted. Could you just switch on your mic?
Well, I think Dave Cole, he may have some, I don't know.
So thank you very much, Alex. Yeah. That was a very, very interesting talk. Because
Yeah, thank you. And
I support that Dave Cole is working with because his model is more complicated. It includes many these units. And that was designed to reproduce in details.
This is Dave Cole checking in. Can you hear me?
We hear you. Okay. It seems you are coming. Okay, so hopefully we can see you, but not yet. Just check your camera. It could be
my camera's on. It is on, but I'm not seeing. Anyway, can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
Just a couple quick points. My more detailed model of the constitutive behavior is based on specific mechanisms. And in contrast to Alexei's kind of broader approach, which is helpful for computations and such, you just don't want to get too involved. But I'd like to point out that the mechanistic approach does a couple things that you would see improving the correspondence of the calculations and the data. Specifically, the single relaxation time approach that Alexei used, effective, it underestimates the anelastic recovery at small times. And the reason for that is it's only got one mechanism that has a fairly long relaxation time. And the detailed model has a grain boundary relaxation process that has a much shorter relaxation time. And so you get much better agreement with the anelastic recovery, say in the first 10 to 20 seconds, than you do with a single mechanism. So there's that point. That would become important if you wanted detailed calculations of, let's say, losses or attenuation for higher frequencies. And I think the way that gets accounted for, the fact that you don't have a grain boundary relaxation with this single mechanism approach, you just wind up with a larger relaxation potential there to account for the fact you're missing some of the grain boundary processes. So there's that point. The other, with regard to temperature effects, so when you develop your constitutive relationship from fundamental principles about the relaxation processes, the temperature dependence of all these deformation processes is embedded in the resulting model. And that's in contrast to this more empirical approach that, again, Alexey was taking as a matter of necessity to simplify things. When you have this detailed model, you actually do have activation energies for each mechanism. Therefore, the temperature dependence naturally comes out of the model. So if we were to say, all right, great. How would the model respond if the temperature was 5 or 10 degrees colder than what was used in Alexei's presentation? Theoretically, at least, this more detailed model would give you credible numbers for a temperature change like that. When you have an empirical approach that is locked into the temperatures of observation, you really have to go back to the drawing board and run more experiments to make any credible decision about what had happened under a temperature change. So, you know, looking ahead, I think as these kind of calculations get more sophisticated, you'd want to think about bringing in a more detailed model because it can answer more questions in terms of applying the model to conditions other than those that were used to develop the model parameters. But yeah, I'd like to echo the comments earlier, Alexei. Very nice job, very clear understanding of a really complicated process. So kudos on that. That's all I have. Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah, I may give some comments that I showed all tests performed with minus 5 Celsius. And that is some threshold when ice is not permeable. And if, but when ice is floating, so then probably minus 5 is mean temperature. But it could be warmer, of course. But how to make test with warmer ice when brine is leaking? And I'm sure that, of course, it will be completely, maybe not completely, but it is very difficult to make test with warm ice.
What we're finding in looking at our data in the field and in the lab on sea ice is that your isothermal lab experiments at warm temperatures produce modulus values that are up to 4 times higher than the modulus you see in situ experiments where the ice has warmed up while it's floating. And it's exactly that brine drainage matter. When the brine can drain out, after you bring it into the lab, well, it isn't participating in the changing properties of the ice as you warm it up, you wind up with more solid ice matrix in the drain sample than you do in the floating sample at warm temperatures. And literally, we have seen for kind of standard, these are conditions down in Antarctica, average ice temperatures of maybe minus 2 or 3. So it was pretty warm, half a meter thick. And we literally saw at that temperature a modulus in situ that was 25% of the value that we see in our laboratory experiments. So it's a major effect. And I think the only way to handle that personally is to come up with a way to do your experiments on floating ice, whether it's in the lab or in the field. When this time temperature history is a factor at warm temperatures, I just don't see a way to reproduce the ice conditions in a drained isothermal sample. I just can't see a way to do that. Maybe there is. Some clever person might come along. But I think to be safe, you would want to at least do some experiments on floating ice to validate any calculations that you're going to come up with.
Yeah. But I'm not sure about experiments on floating ice to measure viscous constant. So that would be of interest because elastic constant, of course, we measure. But viscous constant on floating ice, we didn't try to do it. It would be, of course, of interest.
Yeah, I will confess to being really slow on analyzing some data that we obtained a number of years ago. But I do have data from our floating ice experiments primarily in Antarctica, where we got a little more sophisticated than the work we were doing in the Arctic years before. But I can certainly take a look at that because I can. I do have data that would allow me to look at that specifically, floating ice viscosity and inelasticity. So maybe it'd just be the prod I need to go back and look at those data.
Very interesting. Very interesting. Yeah, Alexei, any other comments from you about the experiments with floating ice?
I may also, but the question maybe again to it is difficult to use for when we consider waves problems. So it is difficult to use complicated model. So anyway, should be some simple assumptions, or maybe Dave, you may tell minimal configuration. Which minimal configuration should be used to model waves?
You mean minimal configuration of the model?
Yeah, minimal configuration. How many relaxation time you need to include in the model, and it would be sufficient to describe wave properties, not behavior of ice in individual test in the lab, but to describe wave propagation over big space where ice properties vary significantly.
Just off the top of my head would be something along the lines of what we did in that paper you and I did a few years ago, Alexei, where we picked a frequency. Yeah, the model's pretty complicated if you want to predict temperature and frequency effects and stress level effects. It does a great job on all those details, but you don't need, I don't think, to carry a model with that level of detail if you're really only interested in one average temperature and one frequency. Then you can greatly simplify, because a lot of the terms in the model will collapse to a constant if you fix frequency and temperature, or average temperature, let's say. Mm-hmm. So that'd be the first approach, and then just run calculations and see how well it does. And then if you need more detail, you can add more detail as you think you need. What strikes me is you have a gradient in temperature and a gradient in stress in through the sheet, and it's not clear to me how accurate an average temperature and average stress level would actually do in an application. I really don't know, but that'd be something to look into. And then if you needed to incorporate gradients in those properties, then you could.
We were looking in this approach because you calculated portion of dissipated energy from elastic energy depending on frequency.
Yeah.
And then it is possible to place in the model, and that is just rest, and that will be one constant. But I have also one constant beta. It is more or less the same.
Yeah, I think that's probably the direction one would go in if that's where the calculations from my model inform your selection of beta. And then the added value would be you could then say, all right, what will the effect of temperature changes or microstructural changes be on beta, or amplitude, what the effects would be in I think my model would help inform those estimates of that quantity under other conditions.
Yeah. And and Peter, what do you know something about wave damping in case of many melt points on the ice?
No, I hadn't looked at that problem.